Hi, I'm Lisa Lockwood. Welcome to West Coast Weekly. We have an exciting show for you today. First up, Nik Halik, the thrillionaire, entrepreneurial alchemist, civilian astronaut, extreme adventurer, keynote speaker, and author of The 5-Day Weekend. Then we have matchmaker Jacqui Holland, who will answer the question, why do we pick the partners that we do? She helps her clients decode their own values, break old patterns, and open up to the loving relationship they've always dreamed of. But first up, Nik Halik.
She was a Desert Storm soldier, beauty pageant contestant, undercover narcotics detective, and SWAT officer. She's a motivational speaker and author, and to no one's surprise, the reinvention expert. She's Lisa Lockwood, and this is West Coast Weekly.
As promised, this incredible adventure, Nik.
Hey, Lisa, how you doing?
Welcome to the show. I'm doing great. I'm blown away by you. Multitude of reasons. Your biography of how you've pivoted in your life over and over again, but not small pivots, extreme pivots. Rock and roll guitarist, astronaut, author, entrepreneur, you just keep on going. First thing that I want to ask you is, 5-Day Weekend.
Yes.
This is what you're on tour with right now, this incredible book.
Definitely, I'm declared war on the 5-Day Work Week. So the 5-Day Week is all about knowing how to keep more money, how to make more money, how to grow more money. So you can live life on your own terms and, you know, be a cyber gypsy. You know, geo lifestyle optimization,
right?
And just build your mosaic and just, you know, have this kaleidoscope as a representation of your life and just have an amazing cosmopolitan lifestyle.
How did you know that you can achieve this? I mean, at what point in your life did
I was 8 when I drafted my screenplay, my top 10 list of goals. So I've been the actor and the producer and director of my own screenplay, which became my top 10 list of goals.
Okay.
And I realized that I need to become an entrepreneur in order to be able to fund these crazy goals that I laid out.
Yes.
And these goals were like, I mean, only a kid could have ever like drafted these up from like, you know.
Because you have no limitations when you're a kid, so you just, the sky's the limit.
When you're 8, the sky's the limit because there's 12 footprints on the moon.
Okay, I like that.
But when you're 8 years of age, I mean, you truly believe you could be anything. Yeah. There's no limitations where academia basically grades you and puts you into certain elements in relation to what you can do, what you can't do in life. I mean, when you're a young kid, the world is your oyster, and it's up to you to like just take massive action and just give yourself permission to succeed and what have you.
Sure. So your top 10 list, talk to us about that.
Having lunch in the shipwreck Titanic. That was a crazy goal. Exploring one of the 100 countries, becoming a multimillionaire, becoming joining a rock band, becoming an astronaut, going to space, to walk on the lunar surface of the moon, which is still, I mean, so of the top 10 list, 8 down and I've got 2 more to go.
Okay, so people who are watching this are blown away, as am I, having knowing what your background is and researching you, having the wonderful opportunity to meet you today. I want to be able to chunk this down to people who say, you know what, I do want the adventure lifestyle, but because yours is so just out of this world and what you've done, let's pull it back a little bit and say, what was the first thing that you accomplished and how did you get there?
Definitely. The first one was basically setting up my own business, for example.
Okay.
And look, a lot of my goals, they're so out there. I mean, your goals can be like, you know, whether it's like, basically raising your family, for example, or having your own Amazon business or a Shopify business.
Sure.
I mean, so long as you've got a goal that you can actually reach whatever to over here. So for me, it was basically building my first business. I was age 14.
Okay.
I sold that business for about $30,000 when I was 17.
And what was that business?
It was basically a music school. Yeah.
Wow.
So I opened up a music school at age 14. At age 15, I discovered leverage and I employed 5 other music instructors.
Okay.
And we were charging.
So you were the instructor initially?
Yes.
You started it.
And then I discovered leverage. So we were charging $20. The house keeps $10. And I sold it for $30,000. And that was my seed money that I used to move to the United States.
Oh my goodness.
Because in 1988, Ronald Reagan was basically espousing the American dream.
Right.
And I came here with 1 guitar and 1 suitcase.
Where did you come from?
Well, originally from Australia, so I'm made in Greece.
Made in Greece, okay.
Made in Greece, raised in Australia.
Yes.
And I've been living in the United States since about age 17 now.
Wow. So Ronnie Reagan was the impetus for your entrepreneurial
Absolutely
insight.
Kind of thing, yeah.
So then when you got here, what happened next?
So within a couple of years, I joined a rock band. I was still underage, basically playing gigs, you know, basically being snuck in through the back door because I wasn't 21.
You were underage, right?
Yeah. I mean, I came here when I was 17 and I joined a rock band at 19. And here I am, like, touring around the world. We're doing stadium, we're doing big concerts, festivals. Touring around the world, we got signed. It was just like 10 years of just mayhem.
Incredible.
You know, and I love the music industry because I was the lead guitarist, you know, it's like
yes!
I was a songwriter. I mean, it was just like, it was probably the most amazing decade. But like anything, it does consume your life.
Sure, and because you're on the road all the time.
It does. I mean, and it became like a day job because I was reliant on the sanity of five other guys in the same band, I guess.
Yes.
And that feeling of being over-reliant on somebody else other than yourself, because I trust my instincts, whatever, too. But in the music industry, I mean, there's a lot of dependency. You're reliant on, you know, record companies and producers and managers and five other guys to, you know.
Yeah, I would imagine if it's different if you're a singer-songwriter, you have more power and control.
Absolutely,
you have
definitely.
No control over the other members.
So in 1998, I left the industry, and my plan was to be stripped back to basics.
Okay.
So I found myself in the Sub-Sahara with the Tuareg tribe.
What is that? Tell me about that.
Basically, they're Bedouins.
They're
Bedouins are just, you know, they travel in these giant caravans.
Yes.
And their quest every day is in search of water. And I wanted to be stripped back to basics. So literally, I did my last gig. About 7 days later, I'm in the desert with the Tuaregs.
You were really on a path of something.
But I needed that to kind of like a control out delete. I needed a reboot.
Okay.
You know, like. But it was probably the best thing I did because it allowed you to expand your bandwidth, extend your runway, and just really just change your level of awareness and sort of scale your thinking kind of it.
Well, what planted the seed for that particular route for you?
I just felt I needed a change.
It,
I needed
a drastic change. Path?
Yeah, yeah. An emotional change.
Sure.
You know, but it was emotional inspiration. There were so many elements to it. And it wasn't the money because I had enough passive income that was coming in to service all my debt and all my expenses. But I needed to discover my why.
Okay.
You know, because, you know, two most important days, the day you were born and the day you discovered why you were born.
Yes, absolutely.
So I needed to get back to that young Nik Halik, that young 8-year-old who wrote down his top 10 list of goals.
Right.
And I got caught up in industry in the music industry for like 10, 12 years. And I needed, and I got stuck.
And didn't you tour with Bon Jovi?
Bon Jovi, Deep Purple.
Oh my God.
Yeah, totally, you know. But I got stuck in a cul-de-sac.
Okay. Okay.
You know,
gotcha.
And and my driveway was circular for quite a few years. And I needed to get out of that, you know, and find my funk again, and get back on that highway kind of thing. And I found the Tuaregs in Morocco to be that pivotal, that level of inspiration, to allow me to streamline what I was going to do for the next 10 years.
And tell me about the next 10 years.
Yeah, so I became a full-time investor and basically created what is called the Financial Freedom Institute, which became a sanctuary for investors or entrepreneurs wanting to like scale up or level up their lives or just raise their level of income, whatever, too.
Okay.
So I started coaching individuals, you know, how to basically find their, you know, how to find their passion, how to monetize their passion, how to basically discover a 5-day a week and a lifestyle, whatever,
sure.
And I did that for a number of years, and now I'm doing a lot more in the television industry. I've got a television show.
Tell me about that.
Which is basically, the premise is interplanetary, intergalactic traveler who crash lands on Earth.
Yes.
And the viewers get to experience Earth for the very first time through the eyes of our mysterious traveler kind of thing.
Oh, I love that.
And we explore different themes. So once again, there's another pivot that's been underway for the last couple of years.
Of course, of course.
But I find it, you know, every 10 years, you've got to pivot to something greater than yourself. And, you know, I at all times, I want to value factor. I want to add value.
Okay.
You know, and that's a really important component because it's, you know, I'm probably the least materialistic person. For me, you know, I'm a big believer that life isn't measured by the amount of breaths that you take, but by the moments that take your breath away.
Absolutely.
That's what I've been chasing all my life, and I'm still doing it. I mean, I plan to be around for a long time. I'm going to be a centenarian. I'm going to live, you know, past the year 2100. I already know it.
Tell me what your family thinks of you. I mean, the risk that you took of coming here to the United States, starting over, and then the past.
I was 17. I finished high school and then moved to California, you know, and I moved to Hollywood.
Of all things.
In an apartment building on Sunset Boulevard. And Hollywood back in 1998 was very different.
Sure.
My mother was like my Obi-Wan Kenobi. You know, like, she believed me. She goes, like, you know, find your path and what have you. You know, just go out there and do it. My father was a bit of a strange guy. He was a communist, right?
Oh.
Typical Greek communist. And because I was moving to an imperialist land like America, the land of capitalism, he didn't speak to me for 18 months, believe it or not.
Okay.
And it wasn't until the Berlin Wall came down that he rang me up and he apologized.
Oh, how
because,
wonderful.
You know, but that was my upbringing. It was very dysfunctional.
Sure.
And I'm the youngest of four kids. I never went to college.
Right.
So my brother became a doctor, my sister became a lawyer, my sister became a psychologist.
Wow.
And I just grew my hair long and moved to Hollywood.
Yes. But look at the life that you created for yourself.
Absolutely.
And I hear a lot of stories like that. Tell me who are some of your mentors and inspirations?
For me, you know, a lot of the historical giants, you know, like Napoleon Hill, Dale Carnegie.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
Definitely up here. But I mean, I just love history. I'm a big, I love reading books. So, you know, I love history, I love reading books. Anything that's going to inspire me, I love individuals that are just changing the course of life, and those who are disrupting life as we know it today, kind of thing. But
disruptors, they're the ones that are making a difference.
I seek inspiration from around the world. I've been to 151 countries now.
Oh my God.
So I have 44 more and I've done the entire planet, you know. After that, I'm probably ripe for alien abduction, I guess. You
know? Well, I know this project that you're working on regarding coming to Earth and seeing it from that perspective.
Yeah.
On your list, you had a goal of becoming an astronaut.
Yep.
You actually went to Russia and trained.
Only because NASA declined me.
Because NASA
declined because you. I know tertiary qualification. I know college degree.
Oh,
so NASA said, what's your college, she asked your college grades, you know? I mean, what do you, I finished high school. I got into university, but I deferred for life.
Yes.
I mean, because my path was elsewhere. So the Russians had a civilian program for individuals, for entrepreneurs who were somewhat cashed up. And the first guy to do this was a guy called Dennis Tito. He's worth about $2.8 billion. And he had paid the Russians $20 million.
Oh my goodness.
To get trained up to become a civilian cosmonaut.
Yes.
And to rocket in a Soyuz rocket to the International Space Station. So about 5 years later, I joined that very same program.
With $20 million? Or you were
with $30 million now.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
The going that was important to you.
The going price right now is actually $109 million for the same program. So there's been seven of us in history that have graduated for the Russian Space Agency, and we're actually civilian cosmonauts.
And I understand that you've maintained your certification.
Yeah, exactly, kind of thing. So I've been the backup in 2008, 2009, and now I'm still actually in mission allocation status for a flight to the ISS.
Yes.
Which is, you know, this $300 billion installation, which is co-owned by Russia and the United States, to spend, you know, about a month up there just flying around like Peter Pan, not walking, and just blocking out the earth with your thumb, kind of thing.
Yes.
And I plan to play guitar up there too. Yeah,
so here's what's really cool about you too that I just learned.
Yep.
So not only are you an astronaut and you're going to be up in the cosmos and doing your thing there,
yep,
but you've, as far as below the surface of the earth, can you tell us about going 5 miles down?
In 2005, I had a lunch on a shipwreck, Titanic.
Oh,
so I dive 5 miles deep with no tether, no chains. Basically, I'm a pressurized biosphere.
Yes.
Open up the ballast tanks and I just sank all the way down to the bottom of the North Atlantic Ocean.
Incredible.
Took about 4 hours to get to the bottom, and we commandeered the biosphere, and we landed on the bow. We became the very first people since the sinking to have lunch on the bow of the shipwrecked Titanic.
Incredible.
But that was amazing. But I tell you what was more amazing than that. For the first 400 meters as we were descending, there was a pod of pilot whales that were circling us.
Yes.
For the first 400 meters as we were descending down.
Incredible.
Like they were like inviting us to their domain because we had these transponders, these like strong radars and sonar, and it was attracting dolphins and bottlenose and pilot whales, but they were just swimming around us. And one basically came to the portal, literally just like trying to look inside what was going on. It was amazing because we're all like lit up inside. We're all like, there's two of us, you know.
Sure.
We're all like, you know, enclosed in this capsule. But to me, that was just like probably the most surreal thing. Titanic was great, but the pilot whales escorting us down, like chaperoning us for the first 400 meters. I mean,
how beautiful!
You can't script that. It's just so beautiful.
No, I love your life. I love what you've accomplished. I love the way that you give back. If people want to contact you, if they want to do, they have some coaching with you,
definitely.
What's the best way to do
that? Individuals can find me on like social media.
Of course.
Just got to follow Nick. But 5 day weekend in all leading bookstores, Amazon, at all the airport stores. But I'm the lead fighter in this and dismantling the 5 day work week to liberate people's lives so they can go out and enjoy life. And
as it should be.
Absolutely.
I love your model. I love your philosophy. Thank you so much
for joining us,
Nick. And we'll be right back.
Hi, my name is Tom Julian, the author of The Shepherd. You know, there's hundreds of thousands of people who have felt like the title character of The Shepherd, Tony Castanelli. Alone, no family to count on, friends are becoming few and far between. But God has a way of looking down on those lonely hearts and somehow in His own beautiful way bring people into our lives who can help us find the direction and purpose that we all need and the happiness we all desire. This is that story. It's a simple read, but it's an inspiring moment. Buy yours today.
Being healthy and happy isn't always easy. Stress at home, at work, trouble sleeping, toxins in the environment. Even healthy foods can be lacking vital micronutrients due to chemicals and depleted soil. American Nutraceuticals' proven solutions can help detoxify, reduce stress, and guide the way to optimum health. Balance, restore, rejuvenate naturally with American Nutraceuticals. Available from leading healthcare professionals and at 888vitality.com.
Hi, I'm Dr. Lee Erin Keneally, and I have some exciting news to tell you. I have launched my book, The Cancer Revolution. Do you know that cancer takes 10 years to develop in your body? That means you have 10 years of opportunity to prevent and reverse early cancer. The Cancer Revolution. It will empower you to change your life and turn this disease around.
My favorite 30 minutes of every day is starting with my sauna. For a stressful day, this is probably one of the best things you could ever get. An amazing platform for natural healing. Oftentimes when people do the weight loss programs, they start feeling like a little yucky during it. If you create or use the infrared sauna, for instance, and you're detoxing along with the weight loss, you won't feel yucky. You'll start, the weight will start peeling off. If you want to learn more about infrared technology, contact us directly. The information is on the bottom of the screen.
Patients ask me every single day about water, but water from your tap? Let's get real. Please, please take care of yourself, save yourself by getting Echo. This machine will put in the activated hydrogen molecule that stimulates the anaerobic organisms that we now know has everything to do with your life. Do yourself a favor, get good clean water powered with Echo.
Welcome back to West Coast Weekly. As promised, we have matchmaker Jacqui Holland. You ever wonder why you pick the partners that you do and it doesn't work out? Well, she's going to help us with that. Jacqui, welcome to the show.
Hi, thank you so much for having me.
Of course. Your journey, all right, this is what I know about you 100%. You are married in a beautiful, healthy relationship with a loving little boy. But it wasn't always like that for you.
No. I was single for a very, very long time and swimming around in the dating pool.
Yes.
Yeah.
So and choosing the wrong partners.
Oh, I was so good at choosing the wrong partners.
So tell me about that. What finally was the key for you to getting it right?
Okay, so what happened was I kind of started studying my own relationships, and I had a background in psychology and NLP, and I started figuring out why I was choosing these partners that were totally wrong for me,
right.
And I was running away from my relationships that were working. So once I was kind of able to figure out what was blocking me, I was able to pick a partner that worked, that I could support, that supported me, and together we could start a life.
And that sounds easy, that you were able to do this research, but it wasn't, because it took you a while to get from A to Z, you know, in that process. So you did study NLP, which is neuro-linguistic programming.
Yes.
The inner conversations that we have with ourselves that can either catapult us or drive us in the other direction.
Right.
To not get the results we want.
Exactly. And sometimes we'll run like the same program over and over again. So that's why a lot of people get stuck in like abusive relationships or verbally
right.
abusive, or they get stuck with people that are just like their parents. Or so
yeah.
We gotta have to change that pattern and break the loop in order to find the right partner.
So do you find with your matchmaking service now that you're actually coaching them? So you're trying to find out what they've done, what their pattern has been,
mm-hmm.
and then what they want, correct?
Exactly.
How do you go through that process with them?
I mean, it really depends on each person. And a lot of the times, a lot of the guys, you know, they want this really, really beautiful woman. And that's great, but, you know, it's harder to find someone just based on looks. Yeah. So I have to do a lot of coaching to help them realize that beauty comes from within and not just on the outside. And I also have to work with the women to understand that, you know, it's not just about you all the time. And also for the guys as well. A partnership is a two-way thing.
And you, I agree with that wholeheartedly. Because sometimes I would imagine that women get caught up with, I look this good and I deserve this. But even they don't have healthy relationships. And they're the ones who are home alone a lot of the times, who look beautiful, and the people don't understand, why don't you have a boyfriend?
Yeah.
But what's the reason?
That's totally the reason. They have no idea how to have a boyfriend. And I'm not gonna say anybody in this room was like that, but I was. And for years, I was just in these relationships where I didn't even know how to give back to another person. And then once I figured that out, I was like, this relationship thing really works, huh?
Do you recommend a certain time frame as far as a couple being together before the proposal happens?
I really don't. I really think the truth is, when you feel that connection with somebody, it can happen as quickly as 3 months. And I don't think that's crazy. With my husband and I, we were engaged less than a year when we were together, maybe 9-10 months.
Okay.
So it can happen really, really fast when you just know. And I don't think there's anything wrong with that at all.
Sure.
I think it's okay.
I'll pull from mine. You know, we're going to give you something personal here.
Yeah.
So I've had two marriages. First marriage was a long engagement, but I was young. Engaged at 18.
Oh, wow.
Married at 21. Lasted almost 8 years, but, you know, there were definitely things that we did not have as far as values and growing during that time.
Right.
Second marriage, phenomenal marriage. Values were there, happened quickly, had a beautiful relationship. And then later on down the road, we just realized that there were certain things moving forward that would not benefit us. So it kind of went the both ways, you know, with the engagement and with the move-in and that sort of thing. I'm currently dating right now. So, you know, maybe I'll use your service.
And you that can would be great.
You can be a matchmaker for me.
I would love to do that and help you find someone amazing.
Tell our viewers the best way to get in touch with you.
Okay, so the best way to get in touch with me is through my website, which is ideservelove.com, or also you can go to my Instagram, which is Jacqui Holland Govea. I spell it kind of weird. It's J-A-C-Q-U-I.
Okay, and then Holland and then Govea is?
Govea, oh my God, that's confusing, isn't it? G-O-V-E-A.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Perfect. Thank you for your wisdom today.
Oh,
I'm so happy about your beautiful, loving marriage and relationship and family. You've done it for yourself, certainly.
Thank you.
You can be the teacher and the coach with your expertise.
thank you for joining us,
Jacqui. And that's our show today on West Coast Weekly. I'm your host, Lisa Lockwood, and we'll see you next week.